Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Murder at the Blarney Bash by Darci Hannah. Narrated by Amy Melissa Bentley. Chapter 1. Wellington! My adorable, fluffy Newfoundland dog was still on the groomer's table as I entered Peggy's pet shop and pooch salon. "You look gorgeous," I told him, because it was true. Welly's silky black coat glistened like a polished onyx. He gave a wag of his bushy tail, indicating he was happy to see me. But he obviously wasn't loving his emergency morning trip to Peggy's salon. Welly was a dog with pendulous, silky black ears and expressive brown eyes, and he was using them to their fullest effect on me now. The look he shot me, lowering his fluffy ears to match his droopy eyes, was filled with such mournful gloom that I almost felt sorry for him. Almost. Welly's long stint on the groomer's table was his own doing. "I hope he smells as good as he looks," I told Peggy. "He ought to," Peggy informed me as she set down her grooming brush. Peggy wasn't only the owner of Peggy's pet shop and pooch salon, but she was also a good friend. The moment I had left my finance career in New York City to open a bakery in a lighthouse in the small village of Beacon Harbor, Michigan, I knew that I was going to need a good groomer for Wellington. My lighthouse was right on the shores of Lake Michigan, and Welly was a breed of dog that couldn't resist the pull of water. Be it giant lake or muddy pond, it made little difference. In the relatively short time I'd been in Beacon Harbor, Peggy and I had become fast friends. This morning, however, she had literally saved me after Wellington had cornered a skunk by the boathouse on his pre-dawn sniffin' dash around the lighthouse grounds. Needless to say, the skunk had gotten the last word in that brief encounter. Peggy continued, "This one spent half the morning in the washtub. You'd imagine that a dog like Wellington, who thinks nothing of swimming in that frozen lake out there, wouldn't mind a nice, sudsy, warm bath every now and again. But you'd be wrong. This big guy sure puts up a fuss. It took three of us and a half box of treats to get him into the tub." "Sorry about that." My apology was genuine. Peggy offered a smile and waved me through the little half gate that separated the reception area from the grooming tables. Welly, I noticed, was the only client currently in the building. I stood beside him and gave him a good sniff. "Wow, I can't believe you got that nasty smell out of his fur. After two baths with the recommended wash, this boy was smelling a whole lot better. Should it ever happen again, Lindsey, you can make the mixture yourself. Just combine 1 quart of hydrogen peroxide with 1/4 cup of baking soda and 1 teaspoon of Dawn dish soap. As you can see, it works like a charm." Peggy was a dear, but I honestly couldn't see myself whipping up that concoction at 4 in the morning. "I never expected the skunk to be out on such a frigid morning. I thought they hibernated," I offered a shrug. After all, it was March in Michigan, which wasn't a whole lot different from February in Michigan. Both months were snowy, dreary, and bitter cold. Although, to be fair, it was gradually warming up, or so the weatherman claimed. But one hardly noticed with the wind chill. Maybe skunks were just a tad more sensitive to the slightest change in temperature, I thought. Peggy, however, knew far more about skunks than I did. It was likely due to her clients having so many encounters with them. "Skunks don't hibernate, Lindsey. They go into a torpor." "It's nearly the same thing, but a torpor doesn't last as long as true hibernation. However, what you and Welly might not have been aware of is that March is prime mating season for skunks." She tied a cute bandana around Welly's neck, adjusted it, then gave his fur a gentle ruffle. That little critter was looking for love, until Welly scared the stink out of him. "Literally," I agreed with a grim smile. "My boathouse still reeks from the encounter. I hope it goes away soon. The grade school leprechaun parade is about to begin any minute now, and, as you know, the Beacon Bakeshop is the end of the parade route. I don't want that lingering nastiness from Mr. Skunk to throw any shade on our festive shamrock sugar cookies and green leprechaun punch. The kids are really looking forward to them, or so I've been told. We had a bit of a rough morning at the bake shop due to that smell. For instance, Betty came in as usual, but she was holding a handkerchief over her nose. She then ordered her usual latte and a cinnamon roll and took it to go. Can you imagine that? Betty Van Hoosen was the owner of Harbor Realty, the president of the Chamber of Commerce, town busybody, and my good friend. She came to the bake shop every morning that we were open and had never taken her latte to go. I can only imagine. Peggy commiserated with a shake of her head. Well, I'm sure that brisk March wind coming off the lake will whisk it away in no time. I hope so. By the way, I love that white shamrock-covered bandana you put on Willie. The kids are going to love it too. It's our March special, she said with a smile. As you know, St. Patrick's Day is tomorrow. After that, we'll pack these beauties away until next year. I also heard through the grapevine that this handsome big guy has an Irish girlfriend. Peggy gave Welly a loving pat, then clicked on his leash, allowing him to escape the grooming table. Welly was overjoyed by this tantalizing glimmer of freedom. He does, I agreed, giving my dog a big hug. The grade school kids were going to love the silkiness of his fur. Wellington was a big draw for the children of the town. It would never do to have him stinking to high heaven. I cast Peggy a grin. He's smitten with Bailey, I told her as I proceeded to the register with her. The Bailey in question was a beautiful, pristine white Great Pyrenees dog that belonged to Finnigan O'Connor, my boyfriend Rory's Irish uncle. Uncle Finn, as he was called, surprised Rory last November when he told his nephew that he and his daughter, Colleen, were moving to Beacon Harbor to open an Irish gift shop and micro pub called the Blarney Stone. Rory was ecstatic. Both his parents had passed before I met him, and he didn't have any close relatives in the area. Uncle Finn was Rory's mother's younger brother, and according to Rory, Uncle Finn was his favorite. My parents lived in Beacon Harbor during the summer months, and I loved having them around. Although they adored Rory and embraced him like family, I always felt a bit sad for my boyfriend for not having that love and support that only parents can give. Therefore, when Finn and Colleen decided to move from their home in Ireland to come to America, we were both thrilled. On a personal note, Finn and Colleen's good news had kept me from focusing on the fact that my best friend, Kennedy Kapoor, had left Beacon Harbor to spend some time with her family in London. It had been a rough October. There'd been a murder on Halloween night in the village, and Kennedy and I had both gotten involved. I didn't blame my friend for leaving, or, to paraphrase her own words, wanting to find herself again. However, by leaving Beacon Harbor, Ken had broken the heart of Tuck McAllister, a young police officer and dear friend to both Rory and me. Of course, Kennedy and I had kept in touch because that's what besties do. However, the passing of time and the distance between us were beginning to wear on our friendship, not to mention her giddy text messages, short phone calls, and unsettling Instagram posts she'd felt inclined to share with the world. I had just paid for Welly's grooming when Peggy hit me with another grin. I also heard another rumor, she ventured. I heard that Kennedy is back in town. I waited a heartbeat too long before I blurted, she is. Got in last night. I better get going. I need to arrive at the beacon before the little leprechauns arrive. Well, the parade has already started, she said, tapping her watch. Great news about Kennedy. I realize that it's probably too early for her to open Ellie and Company for the summer season. It is, I was quick to tell her. My bestie, Kennedy Kapoor, who she was referring to, was not only a famous Instagrammer and fashionista, she was also a co-owner of my mother's seasonal clothing boutique, Ellie and Company. I thought so, Peggy acknowledged with a little nod. Well, she must be visiting then. Good for her. I was simply remarking that Kennedy has quite an eye for pet grooming. When she suggested that teddy bear cut for that darling poodle, Trixie, last October, I thought she was nuts. But boy, was she on to something there. Thanks to Kennedy, Trixie and her owner, Callie, have started a new trend in town. A smile crossed Peggy's lips at the thought. When you see her, tell her I said hello, will you? Of course. But I'm sure you'll be able to tell her yourself. She's going to be at the St. Patrick's Day party at the Blarney Stone tomorrow. Oh, that's right. It's opening day for that darling Irish shop. I hear there's even a little pub there that will only serve Irish beer and whiskey. I've been hankering for a good Guinness. I also know that the Beacon Bakeshop is doing the catering. We are. FYI, we've been going through a lot of green food coloring, as well as quite a bit of Guinness and Bailey's. We're pulling out all the stops for this grand opening. I told her with a grin. Guinness chocolate cupcakes with Bailey's buttercream frosting, shamrock cupcakes, shamrock sugar cookies, creme de menthe brownies, and a Bailey's cheesecake that will knock your socks off. Not to mention samples of Uncle Finn's sticky toffee pudding and Colleen's prize-winning Irish soda bread. I will definitely be there. And an FYI to you, Lindsey Bakewell, that Finnigan O'Connor is quite the charmer. With those dark Celtic looks and that Irish accent, you're going to have every single middle-aged woman in the county there vying for his attention. Hope you're planning on a big crowd. I am, I said, then headed for the door. At the very least, I had to make it back to the Beacon before the parade got there. The annual grade school leprechaun parade was truly going to be a spectacle this year. That was because Finn and Colleen O'Connor, with their gorgeous dog, Bailey, were leading the parade. Having just moved to the village from Ireland, and both possessing charming Irish accents, it was a no-brainer. Plus, their Irish shop was opening on St. Patrick's Day, and to celebrate, they were giving vouchers to every student marching in the parade for a free shamrock good luck charm at the Blarney Stone. Wellie and I were just about to slip through the door when Peggy stopped me. Before you go, I have to ask you a question. Is it just the kids who are dressing up this year? I think so. Why? That's odd, she remarked with a troubled expression. We had a strange occurrence about 10 minutes before you arrived. Wellie started barking at the window, she remarked, pointing at the large front window that overlooked the parking lot. Peggy's salon sat at the corner of 6th Street and Waterfront Drive, which was a couple of blocks from the heart of downtown and one street over from Main Street. I thought he saw you coming in, she continued, but when I turned to look, I swear I saw a leprechaun staring back at me. It was undoubtedly one of the children, I told her, and turned to the door again. Wellie was in a hurry to leave. No. The way she said this stopped me in my tracks. No, it couldn't have been. The person was the size of a child, but his costume was too good, too authentic. He looked like he stepped right out of the history books, wearing an old-fashioned green suit, knee breeches, with a matching green top hat. He had bright orange hair and a long beard of the same color. But I don't think they were fake. If it had been a child, his features would have looked smooth and youthful. He would have been a cute leprechaun, not the ugly, unsightly one staring right back at me with those beady little eyes. There was a touch of concern in her voice as she spoke, but I had the feeling she was pulling my leg. Peggy, the leprechaun you saw was a child wearing a mask. I'm sure of it. They make pretty convincing masks these days, and kids love wearing them. She breathed a sigh of relief, as if the thought had never crossed her mind. That must be it. It was obviously just a mask. Either that, or I saw a real leprechaun. Her unsettling laughter followed Wellie and me out the door. Chapter 2. As I drove out of Peggy's parking lot, I realized that she was correct. Main Street was already blocked off for the parade. It wouldn't be a long parade, I thought, As I avoided the roadblocks by turning down another street that ran parallel to our main downtown shopping district. As I crossed Main Street from two blocks away, I could see the children already marching with their classmates and teachers toward my lighthouse, while their parents, grandparents, and happy villagers lined both sides of the street, clapping and cheering them on. Dressed in their warmest winter gear, every child appeared to be wearing a green top hat and a red beard made from construction paper. For a town that didn't have a true St. Patrick's Day parade, I found the grade school leprechaun parade to be utterly charming. However, I was running late. I knew that Teddy, my fabulous assistant baker, and the rest of the Beacon's excellent staff had everything under control, but I wanted to be there when all those little leprechauns marched into the bake shop to get their St. Patrick's Day treats. "Hang on, Welly," I called to the back seat, getting ready to step on the gas the moment we passed the police station. I looked in the rearview mirror as I spoke and saw my dog already lounging across the seat as if he didn't have a care in the world. His fur glistened. He smelled like a rose. Obviously, the whole skunk incident of the morning had faded from his memory. "If we're late today, it's because of you," I reminded him. As usual, he thought I was talking about a treat and wagged his tail. Then, however, with a suddenness that belied his great size, Welly sprang to his feet and gave a loud series of barks out the window. My entire body flinched from the noise. At that very same moment, something hard careened into the side of the Jeep, causing the entire vehicle to wobble. "What the?" I blurted, hitting the brakes. Welly was still barking as my head swiveled to the passenger side window. It couldn't have been a car that hit us because we were in the middle of the block. I also couldn't see anything that made sense. Then something small and green popped into view. "Heavens," I cried, throwing the Jeep into park. I turned off the engine. The thought that I had just hit a child turned my knees to jelly. Technically, the child had run into the passenger side of the Jeep, but that didn't make me feel any better. It had been quite a loud thud. Feeling a bit sick, I sprang out the door and ran to the other side to see if the child was injured. Poor thing was probably late for the parade, like me, I thought as I leapt onto the curb. Yet to my astonishment, no one was there. Welly, however, was still barking, only this time he was barking out the driver's side window. I ran around the Jeep again and was just in time to see a swiftly moving person, dressed as a leprechaun, turn down a narrow alleyway between two buildings, where he vanished. The thought that my eyes were deceiving me did cross my mind. The person, about the size of a fourth or fifth grader, was wearing a very convincing leprechaun costume, not at all like the construction paper top hat and beard of the school children. He didn't run like a child either. He was swift, yet there'd been a slight limp to his gait, as if he had a knee problem, or was older than he appeared. Of course, hitting my Jeep could have been responsible for that as well. Another thing that struck me was that this small person was carrying a beautifully carved walking stick, the kind Rory's Uncle Finn would call an Irish shillelagh. I closed my eyes and thought of Peggy. I had been so quick to dismiss her leprechaun sighting, and now I felt a bit guilty about it. I wasn't going to be able to explain my sighting either, for fear of sounding like a loon. I now understood how it felt to be that person in the woods who sees a Sasquatch, forgets to take a picture, yet still thinks it's a good idea to tell everyone about the sighting. Crazy. Out of some deep-seated maternal reflex, I called across the empty street, "Are you okay?" My heart still beating like a war drum. "Did I hurt you?" But whoever or whatever had hit my Jeep didn't answer. The leprechaun was gone. I didn't have long to think about the strange encounter, because another startled cry hit my ears, this one coming from the opposite side of the Jeep. Welly, the knucklehead, had spun back around again and continued barking, all the while spitting tendrils of drool all over the insides of the windows. It looked as if a spider with a severe medical condition had tried to make a web in there. Highly disturbing. And I had just cleaned them, too. Help! Quickly! Quickly! The frantic voice not only pulled me from my messy window issue, but it had also struck a nerve. I ran back around the Jeep to the passenger side once again. That's when I saw Mrs. Hinkle running down the steps of the village hall building. The moment she saw me, she began flailing her arms. Lindsey, oh, Lindsey, it's just terrible. We've been attacked. Mrs. Hinkle, are you all right? I ran to meet the older woman. Claire Hinkle had to be in her 70s if she was a day. That's why seeing her move so quickly shocked me. Mrs. Hinkle came to the bake shop every now and again. I knew her to be a sweet, older woman who dedicated much of her life to serving the village of Beacon Harbor. Betty Van Hoosen had told me that Claire Hinkle had worked at Village Hall since she was in her early 20s. Now she was the village clerk, a duty she took very seriously. I'm okay, but did you happen to see a leprechaun run through here? Wow, what was I supposed to say to that? I cleared my throat and offered an unconvincing, possibly? Oddly enough, Mrs. Hinkle seemed satisfied with my answer. I figured as much when I saw you there. She took a deep breath and blurted with renewed anger. That creature attacked Fred Landry in broad daylight. Hearing that, I ran back to the Jeep and popped open the door, releasing Welly. If, by chance, Mrs. Hinkle was mistaken and the attacker was still inside the building, Welly's sheer size and protective instincts would make them think twice about pulling any more shenanigans. Mrs. Hinkle agreed, and together Welly and I followed her into the building. The moment we entered the modest, red brick, two-story building, Welly seemed to pick up on a scent. He sniffed around the floor a moment, then made a beeline for the stairs that led to the second floor and Fred Landry's office. The others have gone to watch the parade, Mrs. Hinkle explained as we followed my dog. I was just on my way there as well when I walked out of my office and looked across the hall. That's when I saw a streak of green behind the desk in Fred's office. Then the leprechaun burst through the door and came towards me, forcing me back into my office. I shut my door, peeked out the window, and watched him disappear down the stairs. I immediately ran to Fred's office to see what the ruckus was all about, thinking it was a disgruntled taxpayer embracing the holiday. We get that all the time, disgruntled taxpayers, she clarified. Not leprechauns. However, when I found Fred lying on the floor, I realized what had happened. He'd been physically attacked. But that's not the strangest part. Mrs. Hinkle was undoubtedly going to tell me just what the strangest part of her story was, when I believe I discovered it myself. Welly had pushed through the office door the moment I had opened it and went directly to Fred Landry. My heart stilled for a beat or two when I saw the poor man laying face down in a pool of his own blood. More disturbingly, he was covered in green and gold glitter. Oh, the glitter! Mrs. Hinkle cried. Why is he covered in glitter? Good Lord, Mr. Landry's been murdered. Quick, call 911. The police are just a few doors down, dear, she reasoned. I was going to fetch the sergeant myself until I saw you. I stood beside the body, careful to avoid stepping in blood, when Welly started to whine. I was still staring at all the glitter. Glitter? The word rang out in my head like a bullet from a shotgun. Blood and glitter were definitely not a good mix. It was highly disturbing and looked utterly surreal. What do you suppose the point of all this glitter is? Mrs. Hinkle asked me. I haven't a clue, but his head's been bashed in. By that nasty leprechaun, she added, crossing her arms on her chest. I honestly couldn't tell what she thought was more disturbing, the thought of a vicious leprechaun with a penchant for glitter, or her dead coworker. Mrs. Hinkle cleared her throat, adding in a much lighter tone. I heard they were a bit ornery, but I've never heard that they were murderers.
They're part of the fairy folk, you know.
Dear heavens, had everybody gone mad? Leprechauns, fairy folk? A man was murdered by some person in a costume who then sprinkled the victim with glitter. This had the mark of a psycho serial killer to me. However, to dear Mrs. Hinkle, I said, I rather think that this is not the work of a leprechaun.
I saw him with my own eyes.
I did too. I don't really know what I saw. Did you make the call yet? I prodded, changing the subject. Just then, however, Welly gave a hefty nudge to the dead man's arm. To my amazement, the dead man let out a soft groan.
He's not dead, Mrs. Hinkle,
I called, dropping to my knees beside Mr. Landry. Hold the police. Call an ambulance first. I would have done it myself if I hadn't left my cell phone in my purse, which was still in my Jeep. Mrs. Hinkle then surprised me by picking up the receiver of Fred's office phone.
You just have to dial 9 to get a line out, she informed me as she made the call.
She then called the police as well. They're closer, she reasoned. The ambulance is coming from the other side of town, and that parade will clog up the works, if you know what I mean. Best try to stop the bleeding.
Right, I said, taking off my coat and rolling up my sleeves.
I looked around the room, hoping to see a towel or something I could use to pack the wound on the back of his head. Mr. Landry's office was impressively tidy. I then noted that Mrs. Hinkle was wearing a smart dress that not only looked comfy, but expensive. I was wearing a pair of dark blue jeans and a lovely moss green cable knit sweater from Mom's collection. The sweater could be replaced. But then another idea struck me. I asked Mrs. Hinkle, got a quarter?
Whatever for?
The wrinkles on her face were even more exaggerated as she asked this. The dispenser in the women's bathroom. A sanitary pad will stop the bleeding. I saw it on television.
Right,
she nodded, sending the ends of her neat, shoulder-length white hair fluttering. She then opened Fred's desk drawer and handed me a fistful of quarters.
Hurry.
Chapter 3.
You're finally here. I was getting worried. Is that blood on your sweater? And glitter?
Teddy Pratt, my excellent assistant baker, was holding a tray of green frosted sugar cookies cut in the shape of shamrocks as he looked at Welly and me. His eyes drifted to Welly, where he spied the green and gold glitter on my dog's nose and the top of his head.
I thought he was at the groomer's.
Teddy looked both intrigued and a tad disturbed as well.
There was a little hiccup between the groomers and getting here.
As I spoke, I pulled Welly to the industrial kitchen sink with me. My big, fluffy dog wasn't officially allowed in the bake shop kitchen for sanitary reasons, but I felt the current circumstances allowed for an exception. Teddy set the tray of cookies on the counter and followed me.
So, what you're telling me is that you haven't been blessed with the luck of the Irish yet? If you go out there with all those cute little leprechauns, your luck is bound to change.
He looked so certain that I almost smiled. I'm about to head out there, but I hope my run of bad luck doesn't follow me. First a skunk attack at dawn, then an emergency at Village Hall.
Was it your water bill?
He questioned with a knowing look.
With all the baking and washing we do, it has to be shocking.
Not my water bill, I assured him. Welly and I were on our way back from the groomers when Mrs. Hinkle, from Village Hall, flagged us down and told us that Fred Landry had been attacked. Of course, Welly and I stopped to help her. I conveniently left out any mention of the angry leprechaun who had hit my Jeep.
That's where that came from?
Teddy, staring at the stain on my lovely sweater, opened a drawer near the sink and handed me a clean wash rag.
I don't know who Fred Landry is, but that's just awful, Lindsey. Is he okay?
There was genuine concern in his bright blue eyes as he spoke. Teddy's endearing look caused tears to well in my own eyes. The trauma of seeing Mr. Landry on the floor of his office suddenly hit me. I doubted I'd ever make sense of it, I thought, as I dabbed at my eyes with the clean rag before turning on the faucet.
I then ran the rag under the warm water. The problem is, I don't think so, Teddy. He was alive when the EMTs came, but the man lost a lot of blood. Whoever attacked him meant to kill him. Lindsey, I'm so sorry.
Thank you, but please don't say anything about this. I don't want to ruin the party.
You got it, boss. Are you okay?
I'm fine. Just a bit of a mess.
I flashed him a watery smile and began washing the blood and glitter off Welly's head and nose. The stain on my sweater was another matter.
Well, you take your time, Linz. Everything has been taken care of. Tom and Elizabeth are serving up the leprechaun punch, and Wendy and Elena have been handling the cookies. We were running low, so I thought I'd bring out the rest of them. FYI, those little leprechauns are adorable. Just pop out when you can.
Thanks, Teddy, will do. I watched as he picked up his tray of cookies again and headed for the door. Yet just before he pushed through to the cafe, he stopped.
I'm confused. If a man was attacked, why is there glitter on your jeans and on Welly's nose? Sure enough, my jeans were glittering with sparkles of green and gold. And even my best efforts couldn't remove all the sparkle from Wellington's newly washed and brushed fur. I looked at Teddy and shrugged. Would you believe a leprechaun?
Funny, but I would. The village is full of them today.
Teddy flashed me a grin before walking out the door.
As anticipated, the moment Welly pranced into the bake shop, the little leprechauns squealed with delight and began lining up to pet him. Although my staff welcomed me with worried glances from their stations, I was quick to ease their minds with a smile and a wave. Noting a little bubble of space near the punch station where Tom and Elizabeth were working, I pulled Welly with me, promising the children that everyone would get a chance to pet him.
We were getting worried about you, boss,
Tom said as he handed a cup of frothy green punch to an adorable little girl. She had big green eyes, strawberry blonde hair, and an impish smile. But what I loved most was that her green leprechaun hat was covered with white flowers and a heavy dose of pink glitter. Had Kennedy been at the bake shop, she would have loved this youngster's stylish flair. As it was, Kennedy had booked a room at the Harbor Hotel. I had offered my guest room, of course, but Kennedy had declined, stating that her new boyfriend, Niall Fitzhugh, was used to a certain level of luxury that the lighthouse just couldn't provide. Knowing a little something about this new man of Ken's, I highly doubted the Harbor Hotel would live up to his expectations either. I hadn't met Niall yet, but I was already beginning to dislike him. I was jaded, of course. Tuck was our good friend, and I hated to see him so glum. Kennedy had broken his heart last November when she had broken up with him and had announced that she was heading back to the UK for a while. The worst part was that I hadn't had the nerve to tell Tuck that Kennedy was back in town with a new boyfriend. I was a spineless chicken. With effort, I banished all thoughts of Kennedy, Niall, and Tuck McAllister from my mind and turned instead to Tom and Elizabeth. We got delayed, I told them truthfully. I'll tell you about it later.
Fair enough, Elizabeth said with a nod. Your green punch is a big hit with the kids. Nice work, Lindsey. We should make some for the grand opening of the Blarney Stone.
Elizabeth, that's a fabulous idea. Remind me to add it to the menu. The creamy green punch was a cinch to make. It was a mixture of frozen limeade, lime sherbet, and ginger ale. When we were asked by the school to provide treats for the parade, I hit the internet in search of inspiration and found the recipe for the green punch. I mixed some up, served it to my crew, and we all agreed it was delicious. I had planned to serve coffee and tea at the grand opening, but adding this simple punch to the menu wouldn't be any trouble at all. Welly loved the attention showered on him and waited patiently as we greeted the cheerful little leprechauns and their parents. However, I could tell that there was another allure in the bake shop vying for his attention. Although the bake shop was filled to the brim with grade schoolers, teachers, and parents, I knew that somewhere behind the wall of green paper hats and smiling faces was Bailey, Uncle Finn's beautiful white dog. Welly, no doubt, knew this too. "Be a good boy, Welly," I told him, slipping him a bacon and cheese-flavored beacon bite right before a little leprechaun boy gave him a big hug. Welly, thank heavens, knew the drill. Just to make sure, I had a boggling supply of beacon bites in the pocket of my sweatshirt. Realizing the stain on my sweater would require some real effort, I opted for the nearest clothing item at hand, an oversized sweatshirt. I looked in the mirror, quickly brushed my long, ash-blonde hair back into place, and brushed on a little mascara as well, to accentuate my light green eyes. Thank goodness my mother was a snowbird, basking in warmer climates, I thought. As the daughter of a former 80s supermodel, even I had to admit that I looked a tad shabby in the baggy gray garment with the words "Lake Life" printed across it. Mom would take one look at me and shake her pretty head, muttering something like, "And I tried so hard to give you a sense of style. This is the best you can do?" Yep, I thought. Children rebelled in odd ways. However, my jeans still sparkled, so that was something. "Lindsey, lass, there you are." The moment I heard Finn O'Connor's voice, I turned to the bake shop door. Over the sea of green leprechaun hats poked a familiar, naughty walking stick. At the sight of Finn's shillelagh, my heart gave a sudden, painful lurch. I had seen one just like it, in the hand of a leprechaun fleeing the scene of a crime. Leprechaun, I thought, realizing how stupid that sounded. I didn't know what I had seen, but I did know that whoever hit my jeep and kept running was carrying a shillelagh. Nonetheless, I excused myself from the children and their parents and headed for the door. Finn was clearly no leprechaun. He was a man in his late 50s who stood just shy of 6 feet and had the same dark-haired, blue-eyed good looks of his nephew. Unlike Rory, however, Finn had a touch of gray at his temples, giving him an air of distinction. Finn and his daughter, Colleen, having led the leprechaun parade, had certainly dressed the part. Finn looked dapper in his driving cap of mossy green, a light brown tweed jacket over a cream-colored cable-knit sweater, and dark brown pants. Having glossed over my share of fashion catalogs in the past, Finn looked as if he'd just come from a long hike on the Irish moors rather than a short march down Main Street. Colleen, standing across from her father, was a black-haired, gray-eyed beauty who looked lovely in her long, white, cable-knit cardigan with bright green shamrocks on the lower hem and collar. Bailey, the Great Pyrenees, sat beside Colleen as she handed out slips of paper to everyone who walked through the door. Welly, of course, made a beeline for his new best friend. "We heard about the skunk," Colleen said, offering a look of condolence. "We don't have them in Ireland, but I hear they're a nuisance. Maybe that's a myth too?" She raised an eyebrow as she looked at Wellington. "He smells just grand." "It's definitely not a myth," I was quick to tell her. "Skunks spray a brand of nastiness that would knock the socks off a pig farmer. The smell is hard to get out as well, but Peggy managed to do it. Welly is good as new." "He is indeed," she said, giving Welly a pat on the head. Welly was too busy licking Bailey's nose to notice. My pooch was such a shameful flirt, it was embarrassing.
"Sure, if this isn't the quaint town you told us it was,"
Finn remarked with a grin. His grin faded as he added,
"But 'tis full of leprechauns."
The way he said this made the hair on the back of my neck stand on end. I got the feeling that Finn wasn't referring to the children of the parade. In fact, the way he was eyeing them with suspicion as he handed out coupons was a little unsettling. "Uncle Finn, you were leading the leprechaun parade," I offered in a teasing manner, hoping to knock the air of suspicion from his eyes. I called him Uncle Finn because he had asked me to.
"Aye, but I've an unsettling feeling. You see, my dear, There are children who dress as leprechauns. And then there are leprechauns who try to pass themselves off as children. Wee tricksters they are. I thought maybe I had seen something strange in the ranks, you see.
The hair on the back of my neck was not only standing on end, but it was also tingling.
Away with you, da, telling your tall tales.
Colleen shot her father a chiding look. Pay him no mind, Lindsey.
A tale, I repeated, breathing a sigh of relief. Right. But the relief I felt was short-lived, because at that moment, Rory Campbell, all 6'4", gorgeous inches of him, came moving at speed to the bake shop door. The door flung back on its hinges, causing the little bell above to jingle a tad too frantically.
Lindsey, he cried with concern. Are you okay? Tox just called. He told me all about the attack on Fred Landry.
I'm fine, I assured him, urging him with my eyes to zip it. It was hardly the time or place to discuss such a thing. However, Finnigan O'Connor's curiosity had been piqued, and the Irishman wasn't about to let the matter drop.
Attack?
He asked his nephew.
'Tis a violent word, Rory man. Who is this Fred Landry you speak of, and what's he done?
He works at Village Hall. We really don't know more than that. I gave a nonchalant wave of my hand, hoping that Rory would get the message.
Yes, we do,
Rory contradicted, looking at me with concern.
You and Claire Hinkle were the first on the scene, according to talk. Officer McAllister,
he clarified for his uncle.
According to him, Fred suffered a mighty blow to his head, causing a lot of
glitter, I cut in. So much glitter. Just then, it dawned on Rory that he was surrounded by a sea of little leprechauns, most of whom were staring up at him with lime green mustaches and partially eaten shamrock cookies in their hands. Welly, wanting to be noticed as well by his second favorite human, curtailed his face-licking barrage on Bailey to sit instead on Rory's feet. Wellington looked up at him and began to whine for attention.
Happy St. Patrick's Day, Rory, dear, I said. Have a cookie. Chapter 4. I'm sorry I didn't call, but there was no time, I explained to Rory as we stood in the lighthouse kitchen. After the leprechaun parade, we had closed the beacon, cleaned up the mess, and I had held a quick staff meeting regarding the preparations for St. Patrick's Day and the grand opening of the Blarney Stone. It was going to be a busy day indeed, but with Teddy Pratt and the rest of my staff on board, I knew we could handle it. What I was having trouble handling at the moment was Rory's look of disappointment. Why hadn't I called him from Village Hall, right after I'd called Tuck? He had asked, looking hurt. Honestly, all I had wanted to do was get back to the bake shop before the parade arrived. That hadn't happened, and quite frankly, I had been a bit frazzled about the rogue leprechaun who had slammed into my Jeep right after assaulting Mr. Landry. Add to that a pre-dawn skunk attack, and it had all the makings of an unsettling day. However, our day was far from over. Rory and I were hosting a pre-St. Patrick's Day dinner party in my newly renovated boathouse, and I still hadn't told Tuck that Kennedy was in town. Unfortunately, he was about to figure that out for himself.
Tuck said that you and Mrs. Hinkle kept mentioning a leprechaun.
Rory cast me a sideways glance as he placed the dinner dishes on a large tray.
What was that all about?
I gave the rich Irish beef and Guinness stew one last stir before returning it to the oven. The savory dish had been simmering in a large Dutch oven at 300 degrees ever since I had gone to fetch Wellington from the pet salon, and it smelled wonderful. Yesterday, I had made two large Bailey's cheesecakes that were still resting in my refrigerator, and Colleen was bringing two loaves of her famous Irish soda bread. Nearly everyone invited had offered to bring something to share at the party, and for that I was grateful. I turned from the stove and said to Rory, I thought he might have mentioned the leprechaun. Mind you, I'm not entirely certain it was a leprechaun we saw, but while Welly and I were driving back from Peggy's pet salon, someone ran right into the side of the Jeep. For one terrifying moment, I thought I had hit a child. I jumped right out to make sure they were okay. That's when I saw a smallish person dressed as a leprechaun running across the street where he disappeared between two buildings. I was just trying to make sense of that when Mrs. Hinkle came running out of Village Hall, waving her hands at me. According to her, she had heard a commotion coming from Fred Landry's office, and when she went to investigate, she thought she saw a leprechaun running away. Obviously, this was the same leprechaun that ran into my Jeep. Rory narrowed his eyes at me.
You don't really believe that you saw a leprechaun, do you, babe? Because it was obviously some person dressed up as one to throw you both off.
After all, the leprechaun parade was going on at the same time.
I bet that whoever this person was planned to blend in with the kids. Maybe he was even somehow connected to the parade.
Like a parent or a teacher? I asked.
Exactly.
He gave a nod as he added cutlery to the tray. It's a good theory, I agreed. But this person I saw wasn't what you would term adult-sized.
You think it was a kid?
This thought concerned him. After all, the parade was for the grade school children. I was quick to set him at ease. No, it wasn't a child, Rory. What fourth or fifth grader could possibly have a beef with the village treasurer?
Good point. At that age, most kids don't even know what a treasurer is. So what you're telling me is that this person you and Mrs. Hinkle saw was the size of a child, dressed like a leprechaun, and had a vendetta against the village treasurer.
Exactly. Oh, I almost forgot. Peggy O'Leary saw him too. He was peeking in the window of her pet salon. She told me Wellington was barking at the window, and when she turned to look, she saw a terrifying sight.
You think she saw the same leprechaun?
There was a heavy dose of suspicion in his voice as he asked this. She said that it couldn't possibly be a child, Rory. His costume was too good, too authentic, as if he'd come right out of the history books.
History books?
He questioned as a sardonic look crossed his face. Okay, old books on folklore then, I corrected, wrinkling my nose at him. Peggy described him as wearing an old-fashioned green suit, knee breeches, with a matching top hat. He had bright orange hair and a long orange beard, and he had beady little eyes. The person who ran into my Jeep and attacked Fred Landry fit her description to a T. Rory stared at me a long moment with his compelling, bright blue gaze, not sure what to make of my story. At last, he let out his breath.
I see. So you, Peggy, and Mrs. Hinkle believe you saw a leprechaun.
We saw a leprechaun, I agreed. But even I know there must be some logical explanation for it. The real question is, why did someone attack Fred Landry?
Rory shrugged. That is the question, and it's worth looking into. I'll do my best to pick Tuck's brain about it.
But not tonight, I warned. Not at dinner. I don't want any mention of the attack or discussion on leprechauns.
Agreed. But on one condition. Next time you hit a leprechaun or stumble across a person who's just been attacked by one, call me. Okay? Look, babe, I'm concerned about you.
Forgetting his tray of plates and cutlery, he came over to wrap me in his arms. Rory had strong, comforting arms. They were arms that a girl could just melt into, which is exactly what I did.
You have a way of stumbling into trouble.
I do, don't I? I'm sorry for not calling you. I was just trying to make it back to the beacon before the children did.
I know. I forgive you, Bakewell.
He convinced me further with a long, passionate kiss. His ardent kisses filled me with new confidence. When I finally pulled away, I said, about Tuck, I forgot to tell him that Kennedy is back in town.
What?
His reaction to this was akin to a man who'd just been jabbed with a hot poker. His arms fell away as he stared at me.
Lindsey, you never told him? He'll be here in 15 minutes.
15 minutes? I looked at my watch just to make sure. We don't have time to discuss this. We need to set the table. Let's just put them as far away from each other as we can.
We can try, he agreed, but I doubt it'll do any good. Kennedy's back in town, babe, and we all know that whenever she's here, trouble follows.
Chapter 5. When Kennedy left Beacon Harbor last November, Rory had come up with the great idea to renovate the old boathouse on the lighthouse property. His plan was partially meant to keep me occupied so that I wouldn't pester him with my concerns about my best friend, and partially to make use of the spacious building that I used as a garage. Honestly, it had been a good plan. Since we were always hosting parties at the lighthouse, and I was always complaining how I needed more space in my dining room for our expanding list of family and friends, Rory had proposed renovating the boathouse into two distinct areas, using a third of the building for a proper two-car garage for me, while turning the larger part into a rustic yet elegant entertaining space. I had loved the idea so much that I instantly called my friend Christy Parks, the owner of Bayside Boutiques and Interiors, to advise me on the interior design of the building. Anders Jorgensen had handled the build-out with the help of Rory and Beacon Bakeshop regular, the semi-retired Bill Morgan and his son, Roger. After 3 months of hard work, the boathouse was finally ready to host its first party, our pre-St. Patrick's Day celebration, and I was bursting with excitement to finally get to show off the gorgeous space. The once solid wall facing the backyard of the lighthouse and lake had been replaced by a window wall system that allowed for spectacular views. In the cold months, the wall would be closed, but in the warm months, an entire section could be opened, allowing the space to feel like an elegant covered patio. In the spring, I had plans to create an actual patio for more entertaining, but for now, with snow still on the ground, a shoveled trail from the lighthouse through the lawn would have to do. At Christie's suggestion, the interior walls of the building had been covered with white shiplap to match the interior of the bake shop and lighthouse. The wood plank ceiling had also been painted with white, while the long back wall had been made into a staging area for entertaining. Since I already had a kitchen in the lighthouse and a professional kitchen in the bakery, I didn't feel that I needed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.